All right. Hello and welcome to the third attempt at starting part four of the Republic Commando retrospective. Today I'm going to have a guest, David Collins. Let me go ahead and give you a quick rundown of who Dave was.
We're stuck in the detention.
Who Dave is and who he was on this project. Let's go ahead. You should be seeing a little slideshow. Yay! We finally got ourselves here. All right, I'm going to pause the game so I can actually talk over that. I first met our guest today, David Collins, when he worked with me on Star Wars Starfighter. I don't remember a lot of those days, except that he was asking for various audio features. I know these were our first couple of games for him at LucasArts. And he then was on, of course, Republic Commando. He stuck around through the reboot of LucasArts and did a whole bunch of projects for them, including the Force Unleashed series and basically anything that would have come through the studio at that time. So that would have been until about 2000. Last time I said 2009, or was it 11, Dave?
2011.
Mm-hmm. And then he switched over to Sony in their Santa Monica office, where he worked on helping out on some of their indie titles that they published, such as The Unfinished Swan and Journey. You can tell us again about Terry Gilliam this time. There's so much good stuff that we lost last time
with
outages. And The Last of Us, of course, and God of War, so, you know, the big Sony titles. He is now an independent and doing his own thing. Welcome aboard, David Collins. Good to have you here.
Thank you. Yeah, it's great to be here, and I'm still waiting for whatever reason this video isn't loading quite, so I'm going to hit refresh, but I am really happy to be here, and, you know, I think you mentioned last time, working on a lot of different projects. Sometimes you're on it for a month, sometimes you're on it for 6 months. In the case of Republic, and the only been this way for me is I worked on it and only Republic Commando for 2 years, 22 months, and that was kind of an interesting time in the studio at LucasArts, because, you know, Darren Stinnett was really adamant about having one audio person responsible for everything coming out of the speakers, voiceover, sound design, and music. I was not the composer on the project. That was Jesse Harlan, who you've had on, who did an incredible job. But I started on Republic Commando before we really had anyone else on it. And what was interesting about that is that this was at a time when the team was really small to be doing a game of this size. I mean, I think we mentioned last time when we tried to do this, it was like, what, 40, 50 people?
Yeah. I think it topped out at about 45, as I recall. So right there in the middle of that.
Yeah, so for the majority of this game, it was one audio person, one music person, and one dialogue editor. And until we got to the end, when the avalanche of all the levels coming on at the same time happened, that's kind of when we went wide and added more people. But there was just a really small core team making this game, and getting to work on it for 2 years means you really got to understand the ins and outs of the design. Of course, we had leads meetings every Friday morning where we discussed everything that was going on.
It was great. It was a time in game development where you could fit whole teams in a room still. You know, and yeah, you'd have the leads, but I mean, yeah, even just the leads these days are a lot of people. You know, so it's really, I mean, game development has really changed, and to a degree, I mean, I really kind of miss the days of kind of somewhat, I don't know, more familial or, you know, at least smaller scale development, just because, you know, it was really great to be able to know it, feel like you could know everybody on a team, and all that stuff. I mean, it's just, those times have changed to a degree. I mean, I was lucky working most recently at Bethesda that have only around 100 people. But it's still, you know, starting to get to be closer to, what's that, Dunbar's number or something like that, the number of people you can actually, you know, feel like you know in a given group. One of the things that we talked a little bit about last time, you know, the obvious audio inspirations for this particular set of levels would have been Alien. But we talked a little bit last time about what sort of separates Star Wars from other sorts of science fiction, you know, in an audio way. I wonder if you could kind of rehash that for our new guests.
Sure. Yeah, I mean, it's more than just... It's funny because looking at these, this really is kind of a... These really are kind of pure sci-fi levels, but Star Wars is part science fiction, but really it's a lot of fantasy, you know? That being said, these are not... This game leans more sci-fi, military, gritty than your average Star Wars game. And it's funny, throughout the years, there was always this push for, like, we want to do Star Wars that's gritty. You know, new people would come in and be like, we've got an idea. We want to do gritty Star Wars. And so I remember thinking, well, we did that with Republic Commando. You know, it was one of those games that kind of flew under the radar, you know, but has just had a really passionate following of people. And it's always brought up as one of those games that people go, God, I had such a great time with that game. And it was in the middle of the prequel era, which at the time was kind of, you know, at least in the gaming press, it was kind of taking a beating, you know, which this game, you know, comes from the prequel era fiction, which really has a lot of incredible ideas, which we later saw in Star Wars: The Clone Wars. You know, seven seasons of The Clone Wars are really, really compelling stuff. Well, not quite seven seasons, but 7 years of development. And this and the Republic Commandos actually show up in The Clone Wars, and was a really great tribute to this game. I remember how excited I was when there was a Trandoshan Wookiee episode in season 3, and Lucasfilm Animation called me asking for my Trandoshan shotgun sounds, because a great example of you know, of a cross between Star Wars and, you know, say a game like Call of Duty or something, is that there are no shotguns in Star Wars,
right.
At least not until this point, you know. And so, what does that sound like? And even this Trandoshan minigun that you're firing here, I remember, is really a cross between some Episode One source from Skywalker Sound. But we also did for a game called Mercenaries, we did a gun recording session out at Peru Canyon, and got a lot of different machine guns and impacts and things like that. And I heavily processed those and mixed those in with Ben Burt's Star Wars work to try and make it a little bit more ballistic sounding. And there was a lot of iteration on the guns. You know, at one point the guns just sounded completely like machine guns, and we had to pull it back and say, well, no, it's not Star Wars enough.
Right. I remember there being an offsite where one of the complaints that people had, somebody brought up, was, you know, the game doesn't feel Star Wars enough. You know, this was, I don't know, I want to say maybe 6 months, well, probably in May or June. I was going to say 6 months before ship, but it was actually 6 months before I left. So, you know, I remember there being a lot of sort of discussion of what do we do to fix, you know, it doesn't feel Star Wars enough. I mean, some of the things were just grittying up the hallways, you know, artistically and stuff like that, and making it a little bit more cluttered environment, like a lived-in space. You know, I think that's definitely a sort of Star Wars thing. But I know the audio probably at that point was part of it as well, at least as far as the guns go, because I do remember, except for the clearly based on, you know, like the bowcaster or whatever, you know, clearly based on sort of Star Wars stuff. I remember that being the case. I'm totally lost in here.
That's all. Yeah, cell. Are you looking for an escape hatch in one of the cells? I recall.
Yeah, something like that. It's giving me a directional. I just forget this thing. Oh yeah, of course. I walked right by it.
Yeah, that was a big push, and a lot of that musically too. I remember at one point Jesse put the Imperial March into a door breach, and I remember one of the producers just shaking his head going, that's not what we're building. Mm-hmm. Fast forward to a year later, that's exactly what people wanted more of. We never put really the Imperial March in the game per se, that I can remember, but we ended up putting in a lot more John Williams music and a lot more of those classic blaster sounds. I incorporated more of the classic blaster sound into the game. But, you know, there's no lightsabers in the game. There's no TIE fighters screaming around in the game. There's none of those iconic sounds. A lot of the ambient sound, a lot of the electrical sounds, a lot of that stuff was all pulled from the library of Star Wars sounds, you know.
Yeah, and then, I mean, one of the things, though, that I noticed, I mean, we talked last time a little bit about Alien and how this is more Alien-like in terms of a level, this sort of middle section. I recently was playing Alien Isolation, so I'm going to cross that in here a little bit. And their audio, there is not a lot of distinction between their environment audio and their creature audio. Like, their creatures sound like the environment. And, of course, that's a way that they use the heightened tension. You know, we didn't quite go that far. How do I turn my headlight on? I forget that key. Let's see. No.
Is it the... What is that key? Is it the T or Q? Or?
Q? I tried Q. No, Q is the...
X? Try X.
X. There you go. Ta-da! There's a little music.
You've got to be kidding.
All these dead... Jesse actually was speaking about that last time, is that this was one of the things that he was like, I've got to have... was late in the project. I've got to have where you, when you're looking at something to know if you've got the headlight on, you know?
Yeah.
He's always had these requests. We're like, oh, God. Can't you just make it sound good without us doing any work?
We just want to know what, well, yeah, and this was really before, I mean, nowadays we have WYs and FMOD, and I'm doing a game right now in WYs, we just call it WYs, not WYs, but it's spelled like WYs. Right. And it's just such a it's such a dream tool that came on after we had tried to build and rebuild and rebuild sound engines multiple times. I mean, my first, I feel like, at least 5 years of game development, especially before Republic Commando and getting to use Unreal, but even Unreal we modified heavily on the sound side of things. My recollection is that we were always building software to build software constantly. It's like half the battle, in fact, I would say, you know, 2/3 of the battle was just trying to build something so I could do something cool with the game. Hey, let's test the sound engine. You know, it's synonymous to, well, I want to mix this movie, but I've got to reinvent Pro Tools and reinvent the projector, and then I need to have a meeting about why it broke down. And you're not mixing the movie, you know. You're actually just sitting there debugging tools. And that was just such an Achilles heel in game development at LucasArts, especially as the company was changing direction quite a bit. And I think one of the things that made Republic Commando so special is that we started with Unreal, and then we just modified it in order to get what we saw on screen to be cooler.
Yeah.
Now,
yeah,
and
it's funny though, because it does, you know, people, I remember the sort of the thinking about it was, well, we started with Unreal, that gives us so much, right? But you still have to do quite a lot of work to make Unreal your own. To be able to do everything you want to do with it. You know, certainly, even today, of course, you'd be doing shader work. Back then, all the shaders would have been, you know, stuff that we wrote in code, and you just sort of turned on or off and applied them to various things. But in terms of audio, I can remember being, you know, 3 months out from leaving, you know, LucasArts, from this project being over, and having to implement, you know, some stuff in this sort of low-level code of Unreal that had to do with, you know, where the sound was in its playing, or, you know, whether it had played, all this sort of stuff that you sort of thought, well, you know, today, these days, you know, that stuff would all just be built into Unity. You wouldn't have to think about it, or Unreal for that matter. And it was sort of a difference. Oh, that's nice and creepy. Well, I forgot some of this stuff in these levels.
Yeah.
Obviously, I got kind of lost there earlier. So, you know, I feel like, yeah, we were always kind of trying to get ahead of the technology curve, both for audio, always trying to, you know, to get ahead of the technology curve enough to be able to make stuff. You spend almost all your time, and part of why there's crunch in games, right, is that you don't even know, you know, what tools you have to make your game until very late in development. Never mind, you know, knowing exactly what game you're making, right? I mean, you just don't, you have all this time where you're like figuring stuff out, and then by the time you've really figured everything out, it's like, oh my God, we have to ship in, you know, 6 or 9 months.
That's so great about sequels too. I mean, when games have sequels, and you know, right after this, I think, you know, Star Wars Battlefront was being done by Pandemic at the time, and Battlefront 2, you know, I worked on Battlefront 2 right after I finished Republic Commando, and it was so obvious to me, like, these guys had made a Clone Wars game in 2002, then they made Battlefront in 2004, then they made Battlefront 2 in 2005. Like, by their third iteration of doing this sort of open world combat type of game, they really knew how to make these things, right? I'm sure you experienced that at Bethesda too. It's like, if you've got the skill set, you've learned the lessons, you've got the knowledge and you've got the tools, now you get to improve upon them. So it's, it, you know, you game sequels. I mean, I'm sitting here playing Arkham Knight this week just going, man, these guys at Rocksteady have really, really refined their core gameplay, and they're adding new features like the Batmobile and exploiting those and tying them in with the rest of the game, you know, the game features. And you can only do that
right, because they've got that sort of base for 30 seconds, you know, really tied down.
Yeah, and you know, you'd be in these meetings and people would come in and be like, let's make an open world Star Wars game, and it's like, well, you know, give us a decade and we'll probably make something that can compete, you know. I mean, that really is kind of the trick to game development, is that these things take years. You know, that's why companies like Rockstar and Blizzard and Bethesda and you know, a lot of studios at Sony, like I, you know, working with Naughty Dog, I mean, they really had the opportunity to just really make incredible games because they know what they're doing. They've had time to really figure it out. And what's great about Republic Commando is that, you know, it was essentially the Starfighter and Jedi Starfighter team, and then moved on to make a shooter. And it was a small enough team that we were really able to kind of figure out a lot of this squad-based stuff. And there were a lot of lessons learned, but they were learned very quickly. And you just had a lot of passionate people that were putting in, you know, nights and weekends just to make cool features, like, you know, Nate Martz making the helmets fly off the Trandoshans, you know, when you shoot them in the head. And, you know,
the rocket launching them too, was him too. And these bodies, dragging the bodies around with your capsule.
Around
the environment. This is all Nathan, you know?
Yep, or the visor wipes, you know, that went in. Those are all, that's all stuff that were just passion projects, and a lot of that stuff happened over a weekend, you know?
Yeah, the passion, that was, I remember the visor wipe, that was Tim Ramsey. And I think
Tim Ramsey.
Right before E3, and he's like, what is this guy shooting at? You know, it was like, well, here we are, we're right before E3, I want to put this thing in, and he shows us, and it's like, oh my god, that's got to go in today, you know? Check it in. How broken is it? Is usually the question we would ask. Like, are we going to notice that it's, you know, totally hosed?
Yeah, and you know what's interesting too about Republic Commando is one of the stories that I remember really well, and I don't know if this has come up before, but late in development, we re-recorded and rewrote pretty much the entire game. I mean, the levels were pretty much done, you know, and the gameplay was done, but in terms of character development kind of the wraparound stories, you know, all the work that Adam Piper did and everybody else in making those cinematics that happened while you were loading the game onto the hard drive. Those happened incredibly late in development, as did the opening tutorial level. And I remember doing the sounds for that opening tutorial level in a day. I mean, it was really like, hey, we're going to make a level where you fly into the Geonosis Arena, and we need all those sounds ready to go. This is the feedback that we're getting. And so Jesse and I, for the opening arena level, we decided, you know, just like they do in Star Wars movies, there should be a part of the movie or a part of the game where you don't have music and you just let the sound kind of carry everything. And so we just had a really, really busy sounding level, and I remember scripting in a ton of stuff where there were just there was just radio communications happening.
Right.
And
I think that had come as a suggestion from Peter Hirschman, if I'm not mistaken, who was
That was Hirschman.
Yeah. Yeah. That was his feedback. Now, he had gone back a little bit of context for people. Peter Hirschman had been an executive producer, I believe, on the Medal of Honor series. You know, so he kind of knew that sort of war game feel pretty well, and he gave us a lot of feedback sort of over the summer. You know, we basically finished this game
October of 2004.
Yeah, October, November. Yeah, like I left at the end of December, so yeah, we were still doing bugs. But yeah, basically October the game was done. We were just fixing whatever tech bugs we had to fix. I'm totally getting behind this guy. Short leather. All right, there we go.
And I remember at the time we were working with novelist Karen Travis on the first Republic Commando novel. And it had actually come out before the game, and she had all these passages of like radio transmissions. And I remember going, well, we don't have time to localize this stuff. I recorded it, you know, and I had joined the union, the actors union, and I for Knights of the Old Republic. and ended up doing a bunch of Trandoshan alien sounds and Sullustans and Twi'leks and stuff like that. So I actually voiced all the Trandoshans in this game myself.
Yeah, you did.
But I ended up recording a lot of this sort of like, you know, and really distorting the living crap out of it and putting that all over the game. And who was it that rewrote the script? Was it Mike Stemley?
Mike Stemley and Ryan Kaufman, I think, were both involved.
Right.
I had forgotten this, but Ryan Kaufman had been the Star Wars in the building. For folks listening, in the building we had a Star Wars sort of expert who was called like the content supervisor or something like that for Star Wars. Justin Lambros was too, and yeah, that's right. Justin Lambros would have been the Star Wars guy. So I guess Ryan we just brought in because Full Throttle 2 had not gone well, and he was available, and because he stuck around for a while, I think, even after this. I don't know about that for sure. I really need to get Kevin Schmidt on here because he was the lead level designer, and he remembers all this stuff.
And he was a massive Star Wars fan.
Oh yes.
Yeah, and so
was and is.
We all were.
Yeah, for sure.
But I remember this was an interesting thing where the president, Jim Ward, pulled me aside and he said, "Hey, George Lucas," he's like, George looked at this game and his feedback was, and here's the interesting thing. We had cast Temeura Morrison, you know, the voice of Jango Fett and the clones in Attack of the Clones, as Boss, the main character. And then I'd had this idea to record a bunch of sound-alikes as the clones so they'd be slightly different.
Right.
You know, they weren't voice matches, they were just more like sound-alikes. But the problem was is that the game was really very kind of, almost like, it sounded monochromatic, if that makes any sense.
Yeah,
it was,
exactly.
it was, everyone was kind of the same. And, you know, when you're working on a licensed project like this, and Episode 3 was in development, but there were a lot of things that were happening that we just weren't privy to because of the secrecy and all that kind of stuff. But George was struggling with the same thing about how do you make the clones feel different?
Right.
And he gave us permission to make them different. He's like, have one of them be, you know, the funny one, and have one of them be, you know, the smart one, and have one of them be the sort of ruthless killer. That all came directly from George as feedback for this game. And so he kind of lifted the shackles off of this time frame for us because, you know, from a canon perspective, we were like, you know, we need to But he's like, well, yeah, I think you can. I think that's part of the story. And then so the whole idea of these guys being sort of the Bad Batch, which is what the clones were. In fact, there was an episode or a whole arc of the Clone Wars called Bad Batch, which we showed at Celebration in April. And a lot of those same ideas from Republic Commando ended up in the Clone Wars.
You ended up on the stage introducing some of this Clone Wars stuff, as I recall. Is that right?
Yeah. Yeah.
So how did that come about?
On the stage, which stage?
I think it would have been either Comic-Con or Celebration. I don't remember which. It was a while back, and I remember that there was like 3 seconds of Delta's footage in the sort of preview they did of one of the Clone Wars seasons, and you were up there on stage. You remember that?
Yeah, yeah.
So what would that have been? It was like the fourth season or something like that. I mean, I didn't really watch the series. But.
Yeah, so it's a fantastic series, and in fact, you know, the way it started versus the way it ended were just so different. You know, I mean, by the time it ended, you know, you had hardcore Star Wars fans and even casual fans just going, you know, really just lamenting the loss of the show because it just got so good. And a lot of these ideas ended up in the Clone Wars series, a lot of the Republic Commando ideas. You know, just as a dev on the game, you'd really dig it. I'll send you an email, but which episodes to watch. But I started demoing, I was, you know, as a core team member, I started demoing at E3 of 2004 for LucasArts because I really wanted to demo Republic Commando, and it went really well. And after that, I just started demoing at E3 every year. Got to know Mary Franklin really well, and, you know, we bonded over being massive Star Wars fans. And I said, if you ever need a host for one of the celebrations, because I ended up demoing Battlefront 2 at Celebration 3 in Indianapolis, And in 2007, she gave me the opportunity to host at Celebration, and I've been hosting Star Wars Celebration ever since. I just did the Anaheim, being the host of the digital stage, and it's really, it all kind of came out of Republic Commando. What's interesting about Republic Commando is that, getting back to the characters, you know, now that we have Sev and Scorch and Boss and Fixer, those names didn't exist. I remember Tim, you know, kind of giving me the rundown of how that was going to work. They were still going to have their numbers, their number designations, but they were going to have different personalities. And George told us, this is a true story, George told us to reach out and ask Robin Williams to play Scorch.
I remember that. that might be a little bit out of our budget there, George.
Yeah. Well, and what, you know, it turns out Robin Williams, huge gamer, right? But he never really did voices in any games, you know? And so we reached out to Robin Williams, and we didn't, you know, we actually did it through Lucasfilm, and the response that we got back was, you know, he respectfully declined. He couldn't do it, but he gave us a list of names to pursue.
Okay. This part of it is news to me, so I'm looking forward to this.
Yeah, one of them was, he was in Willow. He was one of the brownies in Willow.
Okay.
It wasn't Kevin Pollak. It was the other one. Oh, I can't believe I don't remember his name, but he auditioned. He was great. You know, we ended up doing like a full-on audition round, you know, where we went out and we held auditions. And all I did was I sent out the Scorch script and sent it around to a bunch. I was trying to cast Sev first. And so Raphael Sabarge read for Sev. And Raphael Sabarge was, I didn't even realize it at the time, he was Carth Onassis in Star Wars Knights of the Old Republic.
Right.
But he just was so naturally funny as Scorch. And then this guy, Jonathan Cook, who I ended up becoming, you know, friends with over this project because he so badly wanted to do more video game work. Because you can hear him all the time going, next time on Fox. Like he was constantly doing promos, you know. But he read as Sev. I was like, oh, this guy sounds amazing. Fixer, we actually was already using that actor who's known as Kid Beyond, if any of you guys are music fans. His name's Andrew Chaikin. And so we kept him on as Fixer and as the clone advisor because he did a great Temeura Morrison. And then the team flew me to New Zealand to record Temeura Morrison because the whole script was new. So we had to go out and record ton of new mission lines. So I flew to New Zealand for the better part of a week, really late in development. This was like September, and the game finished in like October, November. So I flew to New Zealand beginning of September, and I think that really helped because, you know, we brought in a camera crew and we recorded those behind the scenes features, and he was so cool. Like, I mean, I was, you know, in my 20s at the time, and here I am going to voice direct the voice of Jango Fett. You know, who, by the way, in Once Were Warriors was incredible and terrifying. And this is an...
I remember that movie. That is quite a powerful performance, to be honest.
Yeah, I mean, yeah. Jake the Mushy, you know.
He is Maori, right, as I recall?
Yeah, he is Maori. Yeah, absolutely. And he was so friendly and so cool. And we had such a good time. And I took a laptop and showed him the game, and he got all excited about it. And... you know, and he took me out to dinner, and then at one point I went to go see, like, there was a, if you remember the movie Whale Rider, there was a musical version playing in Auckland, New Zealand, and I went to see that, and he's like, that's funny, I'm going too. And then afterwards we went out, you know, to the bars with the cast and crew of that, and he was introducing me to people and having me greet people with the Maori, you know, the hangi, where you touch foreheads and noses and stuff. Because he was introducing me. This is my friend from Lucasfilm. He's here working on this game, this video game, Republic Commando, you know. And so they were greeting me, you know, with this incredible respect and like, you know, he could have just big leagued me, and he didn't do that at all. He was actually really into it and really fun. We recorded for 2 days, and then I went back and put it all together and that's when the game really came alive. And I think Mike Stemley's humor really comes through in Scorch, who of course went on to, you know, he was a Monkey Island guy and went on to write, you know, a bunch of stuff for, I believe for Telltale?
Yes.
And that humor is really...
You mean Sev. Sev is the funny one.
No, Scorch is the funny one, and Sev is the killer.
I'm sorry. I find Sev the funniest. Even though he's dark, I find him the funniest, personally.
He is. Yeah, and I remember John Hancock. There were a couple of lines in the game that you would hear every once in a while, like, this place gives me the creeps.
Right.
And he kind of hid an Easter egg where when if you say this place gives me the creeps in the third chapter of the game, the Kashyyyk chapter, he finally, like, the other clones start talking back, like, you always say that, or you, every place gives you the creeps, and, you know, they really felt alive, and, you know, by today's standards, they're a little chatty, and we probably could have done more to tune the system, but at the time, it was so satisfying to have so much contextual dialogue happening.
Yeah, absolutely, and one of the things that we had to work on in particular was having that sort of dialogue progress over the course of the game. You know, he wrote a whole system where they would kind of have these little conversations, and it would kind of remember, okay, we already talked about that, so even if something like that happens again, you know, whatever that is, like, I just, you know, killed a bug in close quarters combat or whatever, hand to hand, you know, I don't want to say those things again. So he would kind of keep track of all those sort of events and do that. He did a lot of work to make that really work.
Yeah, he was great. John Hancock was really, I mean, he really was the guy behind the whole AI system of, you know, dialogue cues. I mean, the biggest lesson I took away from John, you know, I mean, I look at this game and I just think, God, I was such a young game developer at this time, and I learned so much on this game. And one of the things I learned from John was, if you want your AI to be smart, you need to make them sound smart. And I thought that was such an incredible and insightful thing. Of course, it works for me because I'm, you know, I was the audio lead, and I was like, great, you know.
But absolutely. The more you can do to help that, the better.
Yeah, he's like, you know, we're spending the time putting in all of these different behaviors. We should expose them to the player with audible cues.
Yes.
Totally makes sense, hindsight being 2020. But when you're starting from nothing, let's get ready. You know, and you're trying to put together a squad game. I mean, there's so many characters on screen all kind of fighting for your ear. And, you know, I remember from a mix standpoint, I mean, I didn't have a lot of mixing technology. I just had a simple ducking mechanism. And that was, and I think that might have been something I asked you for, Brett.
Yeah, it probably was.
I remember asking you that.
We had a ducking system, and...
I remember asking for a certain...
You would have asked me for that, and you asked me for the pitch bending back on the Starfighter games. that was the big thing. It was like, oh, you've got to be able to get a little variety in these explosions, and because we can't fit anymore.
Yeah.
You have to keep in mind that, for people listening, that the original Starfighter actually shipped on a CD, not on a DVD, even though the PlayStation 2 had a DVD drive. DVDs were very expensive. At the time, and they were even more expensive if you had to pay Sony for them to put your game on. So we ended up putting Starfighter on a CD, and so we had to fit all that audio that we had and do the most we could with it, because we only had the, whatever that is, 660 megabytes, which is just, you know, punishing, especially on audio, which tends to take quite a lot of space.
Yeah.
Although it compresses very well.
Starfighter was... I was just an assistant on Starfighter, and I remember asking you for that at the very end, and you seemed very tired, but you were very patient. Like, because, I mean, I was just coming in going, how can I make this better? I'm working on in-game sounds, following up on bugs, while the lead at the time, I think, was mixing the cinematics. And we were just kind of slammed at the end, and I just remember going, gosh, you know, can... What would, you know, how hard would this be? And, you know, you whipped it right together. And I remember on this game, you also gave me, which I can't believe Unreal just didn't have, but a surface table so that I could actually have a layer of abstraction between, you know, footstep markers in the animation system and a lookup table to figure out what surface the characters were actually walking on. And especially
that is exactly the sort of thing that you expect to just have. You know, like, Oh, of course. You know, their games have footsteps in them. Why doesn't it have something sensible?
Yeah, and this is back in the day. I mean, to put things into perspective, for people watching and listening, after making this game, my next really big internally developed title was Star Wars The Force Unleashed. And those experiences were like night and day when it came to budget and team size. You mentioned team size earlier. We had about 100 to 150 people, depending on how many people on ILM and contractors and all that kind of stuff were helping out during different parts of development. But I must have had like 25 people working in sound. I did that thing between Skywalker sound and the engineers. There were four engineers working full-time to rebuild a sound engine from scratch right towards the end of development. I mean, that was a really, really scary project when you're, you know, new consoles, new IP, new story, new technology, new team, new everything happening. And that was really, really, really crazy. But one of the things that was easy about The Force Unleashed compared to Republic Commando is that we had a budget to really go out and, you know, get the sounds that we needed. And I remember it was a big deal at the time for like 2003 to be like, well, I really want to use the crew at Skywalker Sound that is walking all the Foley for the movies to give me, you know, cinematic sounds for a video game. Can we budget that? You know, and I remember almost being scared to ask. I mean, we had just recorded our first orchestra for Indiana Jones and the Emperor's Tomb because Medal of Honor did it with Michael J. And so finally it was like, well, we can record an orchestra too, you know. But there was no orchestral recording budget for Republic Commando, although we did end up going to Seattle to record the men's choir. And between doing that and the Foley and flying to New Zealand and doing those things, like, that was just the very beginning of, hey, let's spend a little money and you actually will get what you pay for. You know, you'll get a really high quality sounding game. And we were so excited about it that we ended up doing, and Steve Matulak thought the process was so cool that we ended up doing a behind the scenes video just on the Foley. Not all the sound, just the Foley.
And that's a great featurette, actually. I mean, that's one of the things that these days, you know, you get that stuff sort of in, you know, movie commentary or whatever, you know, DVD commentary. But back at the time, there wasn't really a lot of that stuff. We had first done it, and we may have been the first ever to do it, with Jedi Starfighter. We had commentary, Darren Stinnett, lead designer, Tim Longo, who was also lead designer on this game, and a level designer, you know, just playing the level, you know, in Jedi Starfighter and recording it. And putting it in as a featurette, and that was like a first.
I remember that. I was in the room for that. I think I made one or two comments in that commentary.
So you were part of that. It's been such a long time since I've watched them, to be honest. I don't remember. But I need to hit these guys with some more heavy artillery. I forget what I have. I'm so busy talking that I'm only kind of barely paying attention to the game. But yeah, it was really cool to have those things, and I guess we set them in as unlocked, and that was kind of how we justified them. Because at the time, in sort of console culture, the idea was, well, you've got to, I mean, as far as we knew, I mean, LucasArts had primarily been a PC shop, but, you know, the thinking was, oh, well, because we're a, because we're a console title, we need to have lots of, you know, like, special unlockable stuff, you know, and that was how we justified doing things like a featurette about the Foley. Oh, geez, another one. And it wasn't something we really knew a lot about, you know, and so I guess that was kind of when we started doing this sort of stuff. And we did one on that. We did one on the sort of having the guest in who taught the team how to walk around an environment as if you're a commando.
Yep. Yeah, an animation one. Yeah, that was great.
Yeah, yeah. So it was a lot of pretty crazy stuff. Of course, we had some guys on the team who were really into doing that anyway. I mean, I remember Lauren Cox and David Bogan and Brett Schultz, Talbot. You know, those guys would make videos all the time just with handhelds, which were also kind of new at the time. You know, kind of cheap, small portable cameras, video cameras. And they would, They would go, you know, they'd go riding around on their little Razor scooters and take video, or they'd make little animations out of clay at the desk. This is all kind of deep diving at this point, but it was just sort of a thing that we were kind of into at the time.
Yeah.
Oh, hopefully I will survive this. I don't want to do this all again. This is a really tough level.
Yeah, this is a tough level. I remember this one really well. Yeah, there were so many. There was a real sense of discovery on this game. You know, a real sense of, you know, I mean, for me, it was such a learning curve in terms of basically doing all the sound and all the integration and trying to sort of politically make sure that I'm not taxing the engineers too much, but at the same time, if it's critical to the game, making sure that, you know, I speak up and ask for it. You know, all the lessons that you learn as a lead, I learned on this game. And it was, and I think it really does kind of coincide with a time, I just saw you die here.
Yeah, I did. I finally bought it. I was really close.
Yeah. It really does coincide with, I think, kind of a growth period in the games industry. I remember this game kind of was in development while everything was changing at LucasArts. Really, really drastic changes, because everything was changing in the games business. You know, suddenly Activision puts out a Spider-Man game when the first Spider-Man movie hits, and everyone buys it. Everybody goes out and buys it. And suddenly it's like, well, why aren't we doing this with Star Wars? You know, we've got these prequel movies happening. And Republic Commando was still kind of the old school LucasArts tradition of, hey, we've got an idea, let's make a cool game. You know, like the green light process was still very kind of old school, you know, from what I understand. And you know,
yeah, it was very project leader based. It was very sort of, I mean, I don't want to say personality based as in a negative way, but very much a personality basis, because Darren Stinnett was very much like, I want to do Star Wars games, and that was kind of his personality, was I want to do these kinds of experiences around Star Wars. Whereas, you know, obviously Tim Schafer is a very different sort of project lead, you know, to come out of LucasArts. You know, he was had a very different sort of aesthetic in terms of what he found interesting. Or, you know, Hal Barwood, or, you know, whatever.
Yeah.
You know, these were all very different sorts of personalities making games.
Yeah.
And that was what really drove the process. I mean, they sort of together as a group of project leaders would basically determine what the next games the company were going to do were going to be, which is really unheard of. You know, I mean, in this day and age, that is not how games get made at all anymore.
Well, yeah, it seems to split. What's interesting is Sony. Sony reminded me a lot of old school LucasArts. You know, you'd have these creatives that were really, you know, really had a lot of power in terms of, hey, I want to make a game that's kind of like this. You know, I mean, they'd still have to go through a pitch and green light process, but, you know, this was very much a creative-led decision, not a marketing decision to make Republic Commando. This is something that, yeah, Darren wanted to do. He wanted to do The Longest Day.
Yep.
Oh, Darren and Tim.
Yeah, and originally, as you say that, you know, The Longest Day was literally The Longest Day on Geonosis. It was all set on that one planet, and happened basically over the course of that campaign in the war. We kind of realized, you know, later on that was just not a selling proposition that worked anymore. You know, that was a little too high concept for our audience, maybe, and it wasn't going to fly. Hopefully somebody can get to it.
What's so interesting is, you know, when we added the... By the way, we didn't know it was called Kashyyyk until episode 3 was, you know, in full-on... did we end up calling it Kashyyyk in this game?
Yes.
Because we called it Kashyyyk. No one knew how it was pronounced until episode 3 was in development.
Yeah, exactly.
You know,
nobody knew how things were pronounced. In fact, here's a true Lucas fact. George pronounces it Hoth, not Hoth.
Yep. Yeah, with system, Naboo, yeah. Yeah.
So like, two. We had no idea how these things were supposed to be named. In fact, going back to, I was just talking about this today with somebody, you know, that we didn't even know when we started making Starfighter, like, which way the ship went. Like, that was how sort of disconnected from sort of the wider Star Wars development universe that LucasArts was, you know, at this point, you know, at this sort of time in LucasArts history. You know, we were, you know, we just didn't have that kind of connection, and I know that that changed. Because certainly you had more of that, you know, moving forward. Oh my goodness, they're everywhere. Who made this level? God damn it. Everywhere yeah. I go, droids. This, I think this whole level was basically to say, oh yeah, you thought droids weren't tough, huh? I'll show you. Anyway, what I was saying was, you know, that we didn't really have kind of a direct line into George, certainly, or into the ranch generally, you know, and so a lot of times when we were making decisions about stuff, we were kind of just figuring out things as we went, you know, and, you know, like the idea of having, you know, clones that were actually different from one another. Part of the reason why we went with the sort of sound-alikes that we had was that we were like, well, they're clones. I mean, the ranch would never let us have them not be clones. Like, and that's what clones meant to us, was like, they're all exactly the same. And yeah, so it was good to have that sort of, have George come and say, oh no, that's not that important.
Yeah.
Just like he did with Samuel L. Jackson and having a purple lightsaber or whatever. You know?
Yeah.
Like, yeah, sure, whatever. You know, I know they're always green or red, but you know, you want to have purple, that's fine, cool.
Yeah, I mean, hindsight, you look back on it and you go, gosh, why did we do that? But I mean, we have to remember that at the time, I mean, you had to get stuff passed through licensing. You know, that licensing had to approve your storylines. They really had to. They were really, you know, they were very careful about that stuff. You know, to their credit. You know, so we couldn't make and invest in design decisions that would lead down really radical paths like that without someone like George's input. So we really needed him to say what he said in order to make the clones different. Because you know, it was a decision that we couldn't really make. And, you know, the movies were in development, so we didn't know what was going to happen in episode 3. All we knew was, you know, in episode 2, they all looked the same, they all sounded the same. And that's all we had to go on. And I remember it wasn't until, you know, we had this idea of making these special troopers, and then we found out at the time that they were making these things called ARC troopers for the Gendy micro series.
Oh, right, yeah. In fact, those I have seen. I did actually check that out. My kids were young when that was first on, and we watched a lot of those from. I think I watched them on DVD. But I am familiar. The what's his name? Tarkovsky or something like that.
Yeah, Gendy Tartakovsky.
Tartakovsky.
Yeah. Yeah, really, really, really great stuff. Yeah, he made the. I believe he did the Samurai Jack cartoon.
Yes. Yeah, and that was actually quite a lively.
Yeah, those were awesome. Those were awesome. I actually didn't end up watching those until just this past year. I started downloading a couple of Samurai Jack episodes. Really, really fun. And it's just amazing, you know, when things are in development, you know, and you're in the middle of movies like that, you don't really know what's going to happen dramatically. You just kind of, you know, try and make a great game. But the game is so much better with the banter. I mean, I actually can't imagine it without those changes. So, you know, to George's credit, we were able to, and it was something that I remember feeling resistant to it at the time. Not that we had any choice, but I mean, it felt very risky, and we were so late in development.
Yeah, and that was really the concern. Was like, that was the biggest concern. Was like, how do we get this done? Like, you know, we've had this stuff locked for ages, you know, and we have no idea how it's going to incorporate and how it's going to feel. You know, we don't have time to even do a scratch track, you know, and so we were really just like, you know, flying by the seat of our pants to incorporate that at that stage of the game. I mean, it was just, I honestly, it's hard for me to imagine us having done it. You know, I just like, how did we even do that? You know,
Well, one of the things at the time, I mean, nowadays you have to ship all the languages and all the localization on one disc at the same time in order to save money. You know, like you just, because you're on Blu-ray, you can do that, right? You can actually fit all those files. And so, like nowadays when we localize titles, I mean, you have to have it so buttoned down at least a couple months in advance so that you can get all the, you know, all the game translated and recorded and edited and put in and then tested by localization testing, you know. And we only really localized this game into five languages totals: English, and then what we call FIGs, French, Italian, German, and Spanish. Whereas a lot of games nowadays, you know, like when I was at Sony, we'd do about, you know, probably 11 or 12 languages.
Yeah, these days you get Russian, Polish, Brazilian, Brazilian Portuguese, I mean.
Yep.
And maybe just straight up European Portuguese. Yeah, it's a whole different thing these days.
Yeah, it's totally different, and because of that, you really have to be buttoned down that late in development. Like, I mean, your last pickup phase, it's always always stressful towards the end because the designers are trying to polish and they're trying to, you know, deal with all the changes and all the bug fixes, and, you know, they want to add dialogue, but we're trying to keep the changes down to a minimum because everything we do, we have to do times 12, and then we have to test it times 12, you know. So for this game, all we really had to do was get it in, get the English in, get the subtitles working, and ship it, because we were going to do the localization. Am I remembering that wrong? But I'm pretty sure that that's how it was back then.
Yeah. No, I think you're right.
About doing all that.
Yeah. Yeah, it's funny. I think the only other language I had ever shipped in was Japanese. Both the Starfighter games were done in Japanese as well.
And that was like two or three months after the game had wrapped. I remember that.
Yeah, they shipped it much later. They basically just paid somebody to, you know, if you're going to Japan, you actually have to have more space for the text, which was another issue. It's like you have to use more memory for all the text because it has to do. You either need to go to basically a wide format of characters like Unicode, or you use something called ShiftJS or something like that. I forget. It's an 8-bit encoding to use like the most common kanji or something that you're going to need. You know, and so you have lots of reasons why you have to do this stuff early, because if you need to go to Unicode, you can't fit, you know, you might not be able to fit your game. Not a lot of text in Republic Commando. Although, do we have subtitles? We must have subtitles.
I think you do, yeah.
Yeah, so all those issues definitely came into play.
And breaks and all that kind of stuff, how it looks on screen, and it's hard to believe too, because I'm looking at the screen, and it looks like you're playing in 16:9, but this was like during the 4:3 era.
It is. I am playing in 16:9. I'm playing. I went in and hacked the file. I think it does. I think the aspect ratio is basically wrong, and it looks kind of wrong.
Like stretched.
Yeah. But it's very playable, so I kind of like to take up the whole monitor. Yeah, this was definitely a 4:3 game.
Yeah.
It was on the last generation of hardware that was all 4:3. And actually, as this came out, there were starting to be games that were 16:9 format and just used bars, you know. Like, I remember Beyond Good and Evil, I think, was around this time, and if I'm not mistaken, I might be wrong about that, but I think it was around this time that was starting to happen in games. Like, Shadow of the Colossus was that one.
You had
those sorts of things. Ah, man, I'm out of ammo again. So that was blown up. Where are they coming from now?
Take them out from there, Duncan. Moving
into position. Slowly. I think I'm gonna actually make it through this time. Oops.
I think you will. I have a good feeling about this.
Commando.
This is a very difficult level.
Yeah.
And I remember it just being chaotic too, because it's a big hangar. So when I first turned the reverb on in this level, I mean, it was just chaos.
Yeah.
So loud and so splashy, and I really had to spend some time, you know, tuning this level so that it still sounded like a hangar, but just wasn't, you know, just total chaos, because that's what it felt like when I first started, you know, all those battle droids and all those explosions going off.
I want to say this was probably Jesse Moore, maybe, was this level, possibly, or maybe Reed Knight. Then Reed Derlich, actually. Now Reed Knight. Oh my god, are there any more? It's gotta be the last one.
You know, one of the things you might not know, but I heard about this a lot, especially after I had left LucasArts in sort of its last few years when they were making games, is that George was constantly bringing up Republic Commando as a game. Make
one like Republic Commando.
But it just, you know, years later ended up being more of a favorite of his, and I don't know if that's because he was just kind of involved in the Clone Wars and he was so deep into those stories, but it was really gratifying to hear because, you know, this game was really kind of the underdog. It wasn't a huge, I mean, it did well, but it wasn't the huge seller that Battlefront was. It was one era. It was the prequel era. There were no hero characters in it. It was all new cast, and there were no Jedi, no lightsabers, and it was kind of sort of on the fringe of what Star Wars was.
Right.
But looking back on it, that's exactly what makes it, I think, so enduring. You know, is that it is different. It is kind of unique. It is video games taking that franchise to a place where it hadn't really gone before and succeeding. You know, and because there are unique characters to the game, there's a real sense of ownership that I feel like the team had over these worlds and these characters. You know, we felt like this was kind of our game and our characters. And you know, you go to these conventions, like you go to Celebration and you see people dressed as RCs and you just think, man, that's so awesome.
Yeah.
You know, the 501st is really into these characters, you know. Getting into these walkers is super fun.
I totally forgotten about this. This is the first time I've seen this, obviously, in over a decade. I think I'm trying to destroy that thing. I had totally forgotten this bit. Yeah, this is major fan service. In fact, when the thing came up, I was like, oh no, I'm not going to fight that thing, am I? I don't think I can do that. I don't have ammo left. Yeah, this is major fan service here. Like, oh, it's time to blow stuff up. Where are they? After you've gone through that really tough period, it's like, now you get to pay back. You're in no danger. Just blow things away.
And I'm amazed too at the things you're able to do in this game that are really just kind of smoke and mirrors. Like, you know, you're not really in that walker. You just like swap out some HUD arms and use the sort of turret technology here, you know, and it makes you, I mean, like, that's not a drivable vehicle, right?
Right.
You get
that's not a vehicle at all. And in fact, I talked about in the first session was, you know, okay, I need to be on the lift.
Hang on, I'm lowering the lift.
Here we go. That we couldn't even do you flying around in a ship. You know?
Yeah.
We had to fake that because it wasn't something you could do in 2004. You know, every game, you know, Halo, whatever, you know, if they had, if they had something where you're flying, you basically became the object. You weren't like a separate physical entity on that thing. It was like, oh, you're now the blue guy on a flying vehicle, you know?
Yeah.
Such a huge amount of physics problems and things like that.
Yeah.
All right, well, we're getting to an hour here, and I'm still dealing with carpal tunnel issues. So I think we're going to wrap it up there.
Great.
Thanks so much for joining me, Dave. I'm going to come back hopefully next week and finish off this section of levels. I see Ryan Pruffledo, and now I know who that is. Okay. Hey, Ryan, how you doing? I'm looking at the chat. Thankfully, there wasn't a ton of questions over there. I think they've learned now that I can't split my attention very well. Anyway, I learned a lot actually this time about things like I vaguely remembered that you went off to New Zealand, but like I never heard about it because we were so busy, you know.
Right.
And that's just that's great to hear. And it was great working with you back then, man. It was a lot of fun. We shipped three games together. There's not a
lot
of people I can say that about.
That's very true. And you know, the Starfighter games. Starfighter and The Force Unleashed were the only two games in my 11 years at LucasArts where I actually got to make sequels to an existing franchise.
Oh, wow.
That's really? How often we would start a game, put it out, and then go, let's do something else.
Let's do something entirely different.
Yep. Starfighter to Jedi Starfighter and Force Unleashed to Force Unleashed 2 were the only times that I watched the internal studio make a sequel.
So really bookending your Star Wars experience.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Wow. Well, thanks so much, Dave Collins. It was great having you on.
Yeah, thank you very much.
Thanks for everyone. Last time I saw you was... Yeah, good to see you too, Ryan, chatting with somebody in the chat. All right. Well, thank you very much, everyone, for stopping by. And I will put this up. It'll be on YouTube presently for those who came in late. Thanks so much. These are really fun to do and to learn even more about the game that I helped make. That's it for now. Take care.
Thanks,
bye.
Brett.
And bye, Dave.
Bye.